Hello everyone, I'm back with my HRV lecture series. I'm Rashmi Mangla, working as an assistant professor for the BBA department of St. Andrews Institute of Technology and Management. We were doing unit 2 of HRV. Now, the topics that we'll be covering today are disadvantaged groups. Disadvantaged groups, may we have various groups that we'll be seeing, but we'll be covering only the two main groups today, women and children. Okay, we'll be studying the provisions regarded to save, you know, provisions that are made to safeguard their rights and with the problems that the women face. Similarly, we'll study the provisions that have been made to safeguard the children's right and the deprivation of children's right. So we'll be studying these main two disadvantaged groups today. So let's begin. Now, when we talk about disadvantaged groups, you know, in our society we have a lot of different kinds of people or different kinds of groups who are prevailing, and all the groups, you know, all the people have some or the other problem. Maybe somebody is mentally disabled, somebody has a physical disability, some of them have lack of money or, you know, lack of some support. So all these people who have, you know, wherein these diversities are created and who have some or the other problem or who are discriminated in some or the other ways, they come under the disadvantaged groups. Let's see in detail. Disadvantaged groups are those groups that face problems. The groups who face problems related to what? Like physical or mental disability, lack of money or economic support, or are without insufficient power or influence, who do not have sufficient power and do not have any influence on the society. Now, our society is consisting of different sets of people. As I told you, there are different people who belong to different cultures, religion, caste, gender, etc. Now, these diversities are responsible to create inequalities in the population. Because of these diversities, we have population inequality. And, you know, in such environment, some groups are exploited, suppressed and discriminated. So because of such inequalities, some groups get exploited or discriminated. And such groups are known as disadvantaged groups. We also call them deprived groups. We also call them underprivileged groups. And we can also call them weaker section in Constitution of India. We call them weaker section also. So let's see the people, you know, the main groups who are come under the deprived ones are. Now, main disadvantaged or deprived groups are as follows. First is women. As I told you, there are many groups, but today we'll be covering only two, that is women and children. Okay. First is women, children, scheduled caste and scheduled tribes, homeless and slum dwellers, physically and mentally handicapped, and refugees and internally displaced persons. So these are all the disadvantaged groups that we have. Now let's begin with the first group, that is children. Sorry, we'll begin with women first. Alright. Now, you know, women are disadvantaged almost all over the world, and not only all over the world, but in comparison to the developed countries, their position is more disadvantageous in developing countries. The countries which are developing, for example, like India, you know, their position is more worse. It is more at disadvantage. And what could be the reason? The reason is poverty. There is social or cultural practices which are adapted in such underdeveloped countries or developing countries. Like in India also, you know, women, they are the most disadvantageous in almost every religion or almost every caste. And, you know, custom or tradition or beliefs and cultural values, they also give a secondary status to the people or to the women mainly. So in India, during pre-independence period, practices like sati, parda and devdasi, they were responsible for the exploitation of women. Because of such kind of practices, they were exploited. So in the constitution, certain provisions were declared so that their rights can be protected, so that they can be protected from such kind of exploitation. So let's see those provisions which were made. So provisions to safeguard the rights of women, there were various provisions. We'll see them one by one. First is Article 14. Now, Article 14 recognized equality and equal protection before law for both men and women. So Article 14 gave them equal laws for both men and women. Article 16 gave equality of opportunity in matters of public appointments for all citizens is guaranteed. And you know, in particular, gender-based discrimination is also avoided. Maybe in respect of employment or an office under the state, gender-based discrimination has been prohibited under Article 16. Then Article 21. Article 21 gave them right to life and liberty to all the citizens without any discrimination. That means nobody can be discriminated and nobody's right to life and liberty can be alienated. Then Article 39D gave them equal pay for equal work without any discrimination, that everybody should be paid equally, men and women. If they are working, if they are doing same similar kind of work, they should be paid equally without any discrimination. Then Article 39A, both men and women have the right to an adequate means of livelihood. Both of them have adequate right, have the right to adequate proper means of livelihood. Article 42, for securing human conditions of work and maternity leave. So various provisions were made under Article 42 also, so that they have proper conditions of work and so that they get maternity relief as well. And you know, not only this, various laws were also enacted. These were some of the provisions that we studied under the Constitution. But not only this, various laws were also enacted in order to prevent their rights. Like we have the Dowry Prohibition Act 1961. We have Child Marriage Restraint Act 1929. We have National Commission of Women Act 1990. And Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act 2005. So there have been various laws that have been enacted by the government and in the Constitution to achieve the objective, that is to protect the rights of the women. Now, not only this, you know, women face a lot of problem in the society. So the prominent problems that is faced by the women are as follows: violence. Now, you know, some forms of violence can be dowry or harassment, bride burning, or it can even be domestic violence, which involves physical and mental harassment of wife by their own husbands, is domestic violence. And when it is done by the whole, you know, in-laws family for dowry, or maybe they are harassed or the brides are burnt, that all is comes under violence, which is very prominent in the Indian society. Then secondly, they face the problem of violation of right to life. Normally, if we see, male-female ratio in other countries is approximately 50-50. But in India, female population has been declining since 1901, if we, you know, take a somewhat ratio. And why is it declining? Because their right to life is violated. At times, people, you know, children, very female feticides are killed. Or maybe, you know, as and when the girl child is born, they are killed in India. So thousands, many of them, not only thousands, you know, many female children are killed right at the stage when they are born, and or maybe right at the stage when they get to know that a baby girl child is yet about to be born. So they kill the feticides also. So that is violation of right to life. Then they face economic exploitation also. Now, women workers, you know, they are economically also exploited. At times, women and men, they are doing the same work, but women are paid less. And that happens mainly in the unorganized sector. So, economical exploitation is also faced by women. Then, deprivation of right to education. Now, in India, you know, in many of the places, in many sectors, or maybe in just, you know, many areas, still it is believed that females or women are only suited to do a certain profession, that is, they are only suited to serve as a wife and mother. So they are not educated. Their right to education is taken away from them. They are not allowed to study in India still. Then deprivation of political rights. Now, women representation in higher political institutions as like parliament and provincial legislation is very less. There is, as we see in India also, there is more of male dominance in the Indian politics also. And a lot of parties, you know, they give very little support to women in election. And only 33% of parliament seats are there for the women. So, although women are making a lot of efforts, but those efforts, you know, they are not appreciated and they are not accepted in the politics also. So their political rights are also deprived. Then deprivation of right to property, as we or you know, it's very, you know, common. In most of the Indian families, women do not own the property in their own name. It is usually in the name of the male. If it is in the father's house, then the property is in the name of the father or the son. If it is in her husband's house, then the property is usually in the name of her husband or her father-in-law. So, in most of the cases, women do not own the property in their own name. Although women have been given, you know, they have been given the right to inheritance. But it's, you know, it is an age-old process which has been going on, that women do not have a share in the property. Or, you know, in case of daughter, they are also not given share in the property of their father, although they actually have a share, but they are never given. Then, deprivation of right to live with dignity. Now, in India, you know, society, in Indian society mainly, not only in India, you know, in the whole society, females, they are not able to live with dignity. Why? Because they face a lot of exploitation. They face a lot of, you know, language abuse, eve teasing, rapes, and all those things, you know, that hamper the self-respect of the women, that violate the self-respect. And it makes them feel inferior, weak, and afraid. So they are denying the right to live with dignity. Then, last problem faced is child marriage. Now, although in India now the laws have been made that a girl cannot be married until she is at least 18 years of age, but this, you know, this phenomenon of child marriage, it has been going on from quite a long time. And it's the main reasons which are linked is poverty, illiteracy, dowry, and various social evils which are attached to it, due to which child marriages are, you know, still in some parts of India, in some very, very, very rural areas, where it doesn't comes to the notice of the, you know, government. So still this problem prevails in India of child marriage. So these are all the problems faced by the first disadvantaged groups, that is women. Now we'll take up the second disadvantaged group, that is children. Now children is another major category, you know, among the all the disadvantaged groups. Women, children, they are one of the major categories whose rights are exploited by the society. See, a child has a number of basic rights like right to life, right to nourishment and basic health care, right to love and affection of family and society, etc. And you know, poverty is one of the main reasons which is responsible for poor medical care, for lack of nutrition, and for lack of educational facilities for children. That is a major reason which is making them deprived of those rights. And you know, as per the UNICEF data, around 100 million children of age below 5 years die every year due to poor medical care. Around 100 million children do not go to school. Around 150 million children are underweight due to lack of nutritious food. So these are the, you know, problems that they face. These are their rights which are deprived. So let's see a few provisions which have been made to safeguard the rights of the children. Now, provisions that have been made in India to safeguard their rights, let's see them one by one. Article 14, it empowers the state to make special provisions for development of women and children. So it empowers the state. The state has got a right that they can make special provisions for the development of women and children if they want. Then Article 15, subclause 3 and 4, for the advancement of socially and economically backward people. This article works for the advancement of socially and economically backward people. Then Article 17 prohibits untouchability in any manner. That means untouchability should not be promoted, it should be stopped. Article 19, it confers freedom of speech, expression to reside in any part of the country and to move. Actually, these are, you know, the kind of general things. Now there are some specific and special rights which are meant only for children also, which I'll tell you. Okay, now Article 19, as I told you, it confers freedom of speech, expression and to reside in any part of the country and to move freely. we are free to speak, we are free to express, and we can move in any part of the country. Then Article 21, it guarantees free life and liberty. Article 23, it prohibits traffic in human beings and abolishes bonded labor. Human trafficking is prohibited, and bonded labor is also prohibited under Article 23. Now these are some of the general rights. Now we have some special rights which are made for specifically for the children, which are, so that's why we have again Article 21. If you can see Article 21, which comes under the special rights of children, it proposes for free and compulsory education to every child in the age group of 6 to 14 years. Alright, that means all the children who are in this age group, they have a right to get free and compulsory education. Then Article 21 is again a special right which is made for children only. It bans the employment of children below 14 years in any factory or mine or hazardous industries to protect their health and development. That is, children who are below the age of 14 years, they cannot be employed in any factory or any mines or any factory which is hazardous to their health and development. So all these things are prohibited, they are banned under Article 24. These are the provisions that have been enacted to safeguard the children's rights. Now we'll see, as we saw the problems faced by women, similarly we'll see the problems that are faced by children. Now, you know, in today's time, children from all the society, they face various difficulties, like beginning from their homes only. So there are some of the issues that deprive a child of their rights, that is deprivation of children's rights. This is deprivation of children's rights, students, as it's not pretty clear here. First one, deprivation of right to education. Now, you know, this is a very basic right that a child has. But in most of the parts of India, this right is denied. They're not given this right. They're not able to exercise this right. Why? Because poor and illiterate people, they do not understand the importance of education. And they don't let their children study, and they think if their children work, they'll be able to earn money for them. So they don't allow them to study, and they put the small children also to work so that they can earn something for their livelihood. So their right to education is deprived. Then deprivation of right to nutritious food and health facilities. Again, you know, poverty is a major reason basically. People who are poor, they are unable to provide their children good nutritious food. They are unable to provide them good health facilities. And that is why the children become malnutritioned. And you know, many children are even born underweight. That means their mothers are also undernourished. That is why the child is also underweight. So just because of the poverty, or maybe because of some other, you know, social reasons, children are deprived of such rights. Then child labor is a very prominent problem in India. You know, it is a home to the largest number of child laborers all over the world. Poverty, lack of social security, or inefficiency in law, they are the main reasons why child labor is prominent in India. And you know, not only that, when parents lose their job, when farmers suicide, in such conditions also, when they, you know, when the economic conditions of the family are not proper, in such conditions also, children have to go to work and they are forced to do child labor. Then last one is children without parents. You know, the children whose parents, maybe they have died, the children who do not have parents, they are at a huge risk of abuse or exploitation. You know, they become deprived of their parental care, maybe because their parents have been separated, maybe because they were ill and they have died, or maybe because the child has left his home himself. So reason might be whatever, but children without parents, they are the most ones who are at huge risk of exploitation. So these are the various issues that are faced by children. That's all for today, students. Let's see the concept, questions based on today's concept. what do disadvantaged groups mean and how women are affected by it. Explain some problems that are faced by women. What is Indian scenario of children's rights and what are the special rights of children? Here are the two special rights which I told you at the last. Those two rights will come under special rights. Okay? And the general ones will come under the basic Indian scenario of children's rights. That's all for today. Stay tuned for the upcoming lectures. Thank you.